Perfect. Okay, so get started. So again, welcome to our first Career Insights of the spring semester. This Career Insights is based on health professions, and I am super excited that we have such a great panel discussion coming your way. I'm Yurelis Canales. I am an advisor and program coordinator at Beyond Barnard. And I'm going to introduce, Romanda, I'm going to have you introduce yourself, who is our moderator for the panel today.
Thank you, Yurelis. Hi, everybody. I am Dr. Amanda Dye. I'm the Director of Advising and Programs here at Beyond Barnard, and I also am a health professions advisor. So I see some familiar names out there, and I'm excited to have you all here with us to talk to some distinguished alums who are in really interesting careers in healthcare. So what we'll do is have our panelists introduce themselves. I have a few questions that are prepared already, and at the end, we'll open it up for additional questions from the group. I wanna let you all know that, as you can probably see, one of our panelists is at work and on call right now. So if you see her disappear, it's because there's a baby on the way. So actually, Martina, can we start with you? Can you tell us a little bit about who you are and what you do?
Sure. So I'm Martina Kvashtin-Skasharek. My pronouns are she and her. I am a certified nurse midwife. I graduated from Barnard in 2008, thinking I was going to be a lawyer, and then realized that that probably wasn't what I wanted to do day to day. And I took the interest that I had actually at Barnard. I worked at the Rape Crisis Center and the Sexual Violence Prevention Response Program, and knew I wanted to work in specifically reproductive rights and reproductive justice, and it brought me to midwifery in a sort of roundabout way. So I work as a certified nurse midwife in Berkeley, California. I'm a full scope midwife, which means I care for people throughout the reproductive lifespan. So I provide gynecological care. So when you come in for an annual, pap smears, STD testing, birth control, menopause care, period issues, as well as obstetric care. So prenatal care, intrapartum care, which is what I'm doing today on labor and delivery, and postpartum care.
Awesome. Thank you. Lisa, how about you go next?
Okay. I'm Lisa Shilowitz, and I am an occupational therapist. I work for the New York City Department of Education. I have a specialty in assistive technology. When I was at Barnard, I knew I wanted to do something that was related to rehab, and I actually didn't know about occupational therapy. I ended up in an internship at Rusk Institute, where I went through all the different types of rehab, speech pathology, PT, OT, hands rehab, and all different, you know, vision therapy. And when I did my OT week when I was there, I fell in love, and then the rest is history.
Great. Liz, how about you?
Sorry, I muted myself again. My name is Liz Scott. I graduated from Barnard in 2011, and I studied English while I was there, and I was really involved with the Columbia Spectator. I thought I wanted to be a journalist. And then I thought, it didn't feel right for me at the end of the day. And I had an interest in medicine. I just had no idea what it was necessarily. So I took a job in clinical research after college at Mount Sinai. I worked in breast cancer research. We did some psychology stuff. I worked with a group called the Mount Sinai Visiting Doctors, which is when I found out about the PA profession, I actually didn't really have much exposure to it. Before that, I thought there were doctors and there were nurses and that was it. And then I thought maybe I wanted to go to medical school. And then the more that I shadowed the PAs and the NPs, I thought that the PA profession ended up being the right fit for me. So I went to PA school, and now I work as a surgery PA at White Plains Hospital. And I live in the city still. So
awesome. Thank you. And our last panelist is Ivy.
Hi, everyone. Similar to Lisa, I'm also an occupational therapist, but I work in a completely different field. I work in acute care at New York Presbyterian Hospital, Columbia. So I work with patients who are very critically ill. I specialize in neurological conditions. I work a lot in the neurological intensive care units and at other of the medical ICUs. I graduated from Barnard in 2015, so I'm more of a recent grad. And I kind of fell into OT similar to everyone else. I had other, you know, career options that I was kind of toying with. But I also really enjoyed medicine, but I didn't necessarily want to go to medical school or be a doctor. And I was a dance major at Barnard and a psychology major. So I wanted something to kind of fit everything that I was interested in. And OT seemed to be the perfect choice.
I'm really glad that you all mentioned, right, like having considered other careers and not necessarily being laser focused on your actual professional paths until a little bit later. That's a big question for lots of our current students, right? Folks maybe know that they're attracted to a profession in which they can help people, you know, maybe broadly in healthcare, but not necessarily knowing exactly which path within healthcare makes the most sense for them. Can you all tell us a little bit about what was it that did it for you, for your own professional path? Like, were there particular characteristics of the work that drew you to your profession versus others in healthcare? And anybody can answer.
I guess I can go. So for me, I did really want to help people and do a profession that would be meaningful to me and feel like I was achieving a greater goal outside of myself. But I also wanted something creative. But I also really like the sciences. So for me to find something that kind of fit all of those things, I didn't think it existed. So I kind of was doing research into the allied health professions. And similar to Lisa, I kind of went through all the different rehab professions, PT, OT, speech, and kind of fell in love with the idea of what occupational therapy is. And for people who aren't familiar, it's, I like to say it's the intersection of art and science. You have a very strong foundation in, you know, anatomy, physiology, neuroscience, all the basic courses that you would take as a health professional. And then you also take extensive coursework, at least in my program, in mental health. And being a psychology major, that was incredibly, you know, attractive too, that there was a profession that kind of merged the two together. Because I'm a firm believer that, you know, your body and mind are really connected there. You can't really separate the two. And then as an occupational therapist, a lot of what you do during the day with patients is very collaborative, very holistic, very creative, very much thinking outside the box to try to figure out how to help a person be, you know, the most independent they can be, regardless of, you know, illness, injury, circumstances. So for me, what ultimately made me fall in love with OT was that interaction between clinician and patient that you have with an OT lens. I liked every aspect that it offered. And the more I worked with patients in different settings, the more I kind of found that for me, working in a hospital setting with really acutely ill people really matched my personality and my, you know, kind of fast-paced environment type of, you know, work that I like to do. So yeah, that was kind of a melting pot of everything that I love doing.
I'm going to jump in here and say that it's funny because I also was a psych major when I was at Barnard, and I always loved the arts and creativity as well. And to me, I totally could echo Ivy's sentiments of that it was really a big merger of that, the ability to bring your creativity with the science. Since high school, I was always into the sciences the problem solving that is involved in everything we do, that we really try to get to the core of it and really look at the individual and connecting to the person you're working with and that individual on what their needs are. It's not what I deem as important, it's what they deem as important. And that really is what stood out to me, was different than so many of the other fields that I considered at the time. That's my
I love that so much. And I think that's kind of midwifery in a nutshell in a way as well. And I think something that really drew me to becoming a nurse midwife rather than an OBGYN so the way that I realized I didn't want to be a lawyer was my senior year at Barnard. I interned at the district attorney's office, and just seeing what the day-to-day of the job actually looked like was different enough from the, you know, fantasy I created in my head or the assumptions I had made that I really had to rethink if that's what I wanted to do on a day-to-day basis. And so I didn't want to make the same mistake going into healthcare because I was a poli-sci major. So I had to do all of my prereqs for healthcare. I didn't take any science classes except for astronomy while I was an undergrad. And so I wanted to make sure I was making the right choice. And so I actually worked as a birth doula in New York City for several years, where I got to go to births and actually be in the labor room at various different hospitals, birth centers, and some home births in New York, and really got to see what does it look like? Like, what does it look like to do this job from at least the perspective of the birthing person? And as a doula, you're a non-medical support person. You're providing informational support, physical support, emotional support during pregnancy and the labor process. But I wanted to be a care provider because I really wanted to sort of change the system, which I really do feel like most healthcare, I think all of us who are interested in working in healthcare feel like healthcare is broken. So we want to make it better. And so specifically maternity care in this country really has an ugly legacy and roots, and which are really becoming apparent more and more and more spoken about in terms of looking at racial disparities in maternal mortality and infant mortality. And so I wanted to work within the system to change it. So that sort of reproductive justice perspective that I was thinking about doing from law, I'm able to do as a provider. And so being a doula and actually getting to see how does care look different on an individual patient care level between an OBGYN, between a midwife, between a professional midwife and a nurse midwife in the hospital, in the home, where do I feel like I can most authentically provide the care that I want to be able to provide, and like, what do I want my job to be? Like, that's really what all of this is. Like, what do I want to do for 8 to 24 hours a day? And and that it feels like I can actually make the most impact and make the most use of my skills. And so as Lisa said, with midwifery, it's a physiologically based approach. And so I think that's the way I describe the difference between physicians and midwives to my patients, is that midwives are the experts in normal. We've been supporting pregnant people and like normal pregnancy and normal birth for 200,000 years. It's like literally a chicken and egg, oldest profession kind of situation. And physicians are trained in pathology. They're trained in problems. They're trained to look for problems and find problems and take care of problems, which is fantastic when you have a problem. But when you're pregnant, like, that's not a disease, and we don't have to cure you from your pregnancy. And so it's sort of, we are in this system, this healthcare system, which is really designed based on pathology and to fix problems. But how do we support wellness and how do we support physiology in there? And I think that any profession that comes from the nursing perspective, so nurse practitioners, nurse midwives, we are also really trained to think of this holistic perspective of how do we meet people where they are? How do we help empower people to identify their own goals and help them reach those goals by sort of being their guide through the system that we're all getting care in?
Thank you. One of the things that's kind of comes to mind for me often, especially as we're kind of talking about choosing these different professions, something that is sometimes mysterious to students is the transition from a liberal arts undergraduate degree to professional training in healthcare. And I wonder if anyone has words of advice or recollections of what it was like to move into a professional training that is going to be very distinct from the studies that one encountered at Barnard, regardless of the undergraduate major. And kind of what helps you manage that transition?
I guess for me, I went straight from Barnard into my graduate program, and I went to Columbia for OT school. So I still was kind of in that student mindset. So the transition was less difficult in that aspect. For me, what kind of, I wouldn't say was difficult or, you know, a harder transition, what was clearly very different was that at Barnard, you do get this liberal arts education that I viewed as kind of getting this global perspective on, you know, life, basically learning, you know, different ways of accepting information, of kind of teaching information, of kind of learning everything there is to learn before you make your final decision in terms of what you want to do, you know, with the rest of your life. Some people are lucky and they find that very early on. I use Barnard as a way to find that. And I took a very a big variety of coursework because I was all over the place in terms of like what I wanted to do. So it was a good groundwork for giving me a really diverse like fund of knowledge of different areas of life. I was by no means an expert in anything, but I was well-rounded. And then when I transitioned into OT school, the focus kind of shifted, and it's, you do get explicit training for a very explicit like field. So everything that I was learning in school all of a sudden had this different importance on it, because these skills that I was learning would eventually translate to patient care. So it was less about me taking, you know, this art history class at Barnard that I knew was never going to be in the field of art history, but it was interesting to me to learn about. And, you know, I studied for the exams and everything, but everything was kind of just like surface level. Like I was never going to practically use it. It was great and interesting, but when you start working in a school environment where the things you're learning, you're actually going to be using in a practical sense, it's almost, there's almost a little bit more pressure to kind of learn it and know it and not just study for tests for the sake of a good grade or to pass. You learn it because you're going to need to use it. And what I liked about, you know, Columbia's program was that grades, you know, obviously are important, but it was very much emphasized to us by the professors and our advisors and, you know, professionals that we were shadowing that we shouldn't look at it like that, that you should look at it as, you're learning the skills you need to learn in order to ultimately help people. So the coursework that I took, while it was vigorous and really stressful, and, you know, of course we were, you know, anxious about tests and papers and things like that, that anxiety you normally have in a school environment about getting good grades and passing and having a certain GPA, all of that went out the window. It was more like, oh man, if I don't know this, how am I going to handle this situation in the future? How am I gonna be able to provide the best care? So I think for me, it was more that mental shift in why I was learning the things I was learning.
It's a great point.
I think I agree. I had the like a very similar experience, and I think that in the beginning of PA school, I felt a lot of this similar pressure of I'm not just learning this. It doesn't matter if I forget who wrote that poem. This matters. But I also feel like I learned from my advisors that it was almost like, you know, of course I need to learn this and pass my boards and be competent. But this, all of it was sort of a first pass. It's something that I would be doing over and over. I'd meet more people. I'd develop my own style, whether it's physical exam or, you know, just different things, different learning styles, learning from different resources, things like that. It almost, for me, it was a little bit reassuring to know that I would always be a student. I wasn't always going to know everything. And I've been a PA now for a year, and I still feel like I don't know anything. And, you know, but it's nice that there's always, it's kind of exciting for me that I'm always going to be learning and that I could switch. You know, right now I'm in surgery and I can switch into cardiology and sort of start from scratch and learn something new, which is exciting. One of the reasons I chose the PA profession was the lateral, mm-hmm. the flexibility.
Definitely. I've heard that a lot from people who are considering health professions. That's something about PA that really appeals to lots of people, that ability to kind of re-specialize based on work rather than specifically like kind of school-based training. Other thoughts on transition?
I can speak that just logistically, Barnard is really expensive. And if you have to take more classes to get into the graduate program you want, it may not be accessible to continue to take those classes at Barnard after your 4 years. And so I actually I had already graduated and needed to take all of my prereqs. And so I went to BMCC for my prereqs, and it was fantastic because it's the material. They have a lot of night classes. They have a lot of weekend classes. So I actually worked full time at Barnard, got, you know, tuition reimbursement is one of my benefits, which covered a class a semester. And actually the majority of the people who I ended up going to UCSF for midwifery school, but the other places with midwifery programs are like Yale and Penn and Vanderbilt. And almost everyone I know went to community college for their prereqs because most people found nurse practitioner or midwifery later in life. And we were out of undergrad and had already worked for a few years. And I think it actually brought a real wealth of diversity in terms of diverse life experiences as well as backgrounds. For once we were in the master's degree, that a lot, most of us have had worked and had different experiences to draw from and didn't have the ability to do like a post-bac program where you continue being a student full-time. And I also met a lot of pre-nursing students at BMCC who I'm still friends with, just because we were all doing the same thing. We're all working full-time while taking night classes.
I can echo what Martina said. I also had to take a couple of, I think it was like two prerequisite classes before I could apply to OT school. And I also took them at a community college in New Jersey for the same reason. Barnard's very expensive. And if you go into a graduate program, unfortunately in this country, majority of people who do so need to take out loans. So I knew that that was in my future. So I, you know, and I found it to be a really great experience too, kind of going into a community college setting and just seeing the differences and being exposed to different kinds of people and different, you know, everyone was there to do prerequisites for an allied health profession. So we all kind of like talked about how, you know, none of us wanted to be doctors, but we didn't know what else we wanted to be. And it was a good kind of like camaraderie trying to like, you know, explain to one another how we got to be in this, you know, anatomy physiology lab and where everyone was going next. But I think practically speaking too, it's sometimes hard in a liberal arts school to transition to a more healthcare, medical, scientific field because the purpose of a liberal arts school is not necessarily to have that targeted training towards that. But it can be done and it's can be done feasibly even if you are someone who like me, finances were a very big concern.
Very good points. Yeah.
I did all of my prereqs while I was in Barnard. And that was, it was a real balance between lots of the heavy sciences. And I loved that that balance. And it definitely was a transition when I started in graduate school. There was the intensity of graduate school, because I knew that this was something like, you know, echoing what has been said, that is going to be used on a daily basis. And it was also an intense path of all the courses in the same way. So thankfully I really enjoyed it, but you have to know you're going to enjoy that. You're not going to have that variation when you're in graduate school that you have in undergrad.
Definitely. Some good tips there. Lots of prereqs for our allied health professions are easier to find at public institutions because they have undergraduate health professions degrees. And Martina, I love what you said, work for a college, work for a university if you're working, because tuition benefits are real and are very, very helpful for situations like this. I want to talk a little bit about kind of thinking broadly about, you know, each of your professional practices now. You know, if a student is trying to kind of match themselves with a profession, sometimes we like to talk about things like skills and competencies that are really valuable for any given health profession. So knowing that no one's going to be able to give an exhaustive list, I'd love it if you could each kind of highlight a competency or two that you think is particularly important in the work that you do day to day.
I'm happy to start. So I said it before, I'm an occupational therapist with pediatrics. I'm currently working in the school system. And I think the one skill set in this arena that on all health fields you need is that ability to connect. But in OT is really thinking outside of the box. That really each, there's no two, I've never had two students that have presented exactly the same, have the same exact treatment or the same exact, you know, and it's the fun part. It's how do I engage somebody that they will want to be engaged? Occupational therapy is all about the occupation. It's about what makes a person engaged and meaningful and purposeful. And for a kid, it's play. And so it's taking a game of Connect Four and adding letters to it and doing all different things. And so I think, you know, definitely thinking outside of the box is something that is important in what I do.
I think going off of that, since I do work in a completely different setting, when you work in a more, you know, hospital-based setting or critical care setting, the skills that I need to have kind of fit that environment a little bit more. And that's, you know, doing well in high stress environments, you know, being able to think quickly on your feet, always kind of having plan B and plan C and plan D in the back of your head. And then also knowing that the physical ailments that a person presents with can affect the brain too, and the mental health aspect that goes into people being in a hospital for extended periods of time, especially during, you know, the pandemic, the isolation that occurs in a hospital environment, the fear, the anxiety, the uncertainty, people talking to you in, you know, words that you don't necessarily maybe understand, medical terms, having things attached to you. So having that compassion, I think, is a big part of that, and having empathy and being able to kind of put yourself in another person's shoes, switch the view, and see, you know, how that can affect a person's, you know, day-to-day life. So I definitely think, you know, as OT as a whole, thinking outside the box for sure, having that empathy, compassion, and then also, you know, knowing that your goal isn't to tell someone what to do or what's right or what's the best choice for their life, but kind of meeting them where they're at and, you know, being incredibly humble and taking a back seat, and you're kind of just facilitating and steering rather than driving. But, you know, when you work in different settings as an OT, each different, you know, school-based OT is very different than hospital-based OT, which is very different than outpatient therapy or a sensory gym, pediatrics versus adults versus geriatrics. You work with people of all, you know, ages and at all walks of life. And that's another, you know, great thing about OT is that you can work in any setting you really like. If I get bored one day and don't no longer want to work in a hospital, or my body starts shutting down, I can't, you know, lift these heavy patients out of bed anymore, then, you know, I can transition to an outpatient setting. So the versatility and, you know, being okay with flexibility is also, I think, a good skill you probably need to have to enter the field of OT.
What I didn't know when I went into OT was really how we both have the same degree and background, but our jobs, our day-to-day look totally different. And that's just something to think about, that there's really so many different ways you could use this degree in a meaningful way, and it could evolve. I started off with early intervention, kids 0 to 3. Now I see kids from 5 to 21, and my career has just totally evolved in directions. Something to think about.
I bet you see the same kind of thing, Liz, like your classmates from your PA program probably all work in very different contexts.
Yeah, I was actually going to say being flexible is one of the most important things because of course you get the freedom to pursue what you know, a wide variety of roles, hospital, outpatient, you know, in the operating room, even among my colleagues that work in surgery. Personally, I'm just not that interested in the operating room. I mean, it's cool to see and have done, but I don't want to spend all day in there. Some of my colleagues do. So we have, you know, some of my colleagues spend all day just assisting in the OR, and I have no desire. And then we have hybrid PAs who, you know, they're out on the floor seeing consults with us, taking care of the patients on the floor, and then they're also in the OR. So, and then I think one of the things, sometimes you might not get like anything in life, the first job that you want out of PA school may not be the field that you want. It may be that you have to sort of, you know, you get your first job, you get some experience, and then you can kind of go from there, but you have to be flexible. And different PA roles also look very different in different hospitals, even if it's sort of exactly the same. You know, a surgery PA at a different hospital from my hospital doesn't see consults in the ED necessarily, or they, you know, things just work differently. The way that they work with the surgeons is different. The way that they work with the hospitalists is different. So being flexible is really important, but it's great too, because you're going to find something out there that you like.
Awesome.
I would add physical flexibility is a really good strength when you're a midwife. There's so many times where I'm just like in a really weird position because I'm following my patient around as they're laboring and I'm just like, I'm gonna catch a baby like this. But similarly to what everyone else said, there's so much movement for what your day-to-day job can look like within every health profession. And so I think the average time that midwives work full-time, full scope is 6 years, which is crazy when you think, I'm like, that's longer, that's less time than it took me to take my prereqs and get through school. But most people specialize as either inpatient only, so labor and delivery and postpartum in the hospital, or outpatient only, so in a clinic. Huge numbers of midwives work in Planned Parenthood and federally qualified health centers. People work at home, people have private practices. And so what your schedule might look like is very different. What kind of environment you're in is very different. And so if you want to be in a sort of fast pace, unpredictable, prone to emergency environment, being in a hospital is absolutely available. And if you'd rather have like a clinic job, like that's more 9 to 5, then that's also available. And that's going to change throughout your life and throughout your career.
Definitely. I think that's a really important point. I think for health professions generally, you know, there's no one standard for any kind of professional practice within healthcare. You know, your day-to-day is going to look very different depending on the institution, the specifics of your role, your own kind of needs and limitations at any given time. And it's very natural, even for people who train for these careers in which you require a lot of work, all of that sort of stuff, it's very natural for there to be differences over time. And I think this is actually kind of a good transition into talking a little bit about the pandemic and how that has affected you all in terms of the professional practice, as well as just, you know, your perspective on healthcare professions. So I'd love to open it up for thoughts about maybe how your approach to your work has changed in logistical ways, but also in kind of more philosophical ways.
I can start it off. So working in a hospital, especially, you know, NYP Columbia, it's in the heart of Washington Heights. It is the population that was hit the hardest by, you know, COVID. People who have very limited access to primary care, people who have to work, jobs that were considered essential. They live in multi-generational housing. Most people are Hispanic or minority population. And that's what my majority of my patient population is the community. And then we also get people come to Columbia for specialized care because they're known for, you know, certain specialties. But my day-to-day as an OT working in a hospital setting was completely flipped on end. Like the very first wave, no one really knew what to do. So I was doing jobs that I'm not qualified for because we needed manpower. I was with radiologists taking chest x-rays of patients in the intensive care units. I was a nursing assistant. I was helping nurses who were, you know, unable to kind of, they were spread too thin. They were unable to carry out every single job that they normally do. So I helped out with them. I, you know, helped with transporting patients from point A to point B. I was literally doing every job in the hospital at a certain point, and so was everyone else. And, you know, a lot of things occurred during the pandemic working in a hospital environment that I will never really be able to talk about. I actually was diagnosed with PTSD during the pandemic because of the work that I was doing in a hospital environment. Even though I witnessed some very horrible, really unspeakable things, what it made me realize is just how important healthcare is, how much this profession is truly about helping people. Even on the brink of disaster and almost warlike conditions, you are needed and people need help. And even if it comes at a personal toll, it just kind of shows you how valuable it is. I had a lot of colleagues unfortunately quit or completely change fields or also get diagnosed with PTSD or other, you know, mental health conditions. So we're still kind of like recuperating, And fortunately for me, I was able to kind of get the help that I needed in order to kind of get my mind back in the game and realize that, okay, this is actually something I want to do. And, you know, as an OT, the skills that we had in terms of mobilizing patients and the clinical skills that we had, we were used a lot with helping the medical teams do what's called the proning protocol. So I don't know if some people might be familiar with it, you know, seeing it on the news or reading about it. And it's when patients were kind of essentially flipped from their supine position onto a prone position, so onto their stomachs, to help them survive because their lungs were no longer able to function at the level that they, you know, could. And that was something that we had to do as OTs and as PTs. We helped mobilize people. So you know, I think like every profession, not even healthcare, your job changed so much during the pandemic, but healthcare specifically, a lot changed, but a lot didn't. Even though I was doing roles that I never thought I would ever do, at the end of the day, it was still about the person in front of you. Like, what can we do to make sure this person is okay? And that, you know, if you're someone, you know, who was kind of toying with the idea of healthcare, or you weren't sure if you wanted to continue being in healthcare, I think the pandemic was a good kind of decision maker that helped people realize, okay, this is actually something I want to do. Even though I'm miserable right now, this is something that I really enjoy and is really meaningful to me, or this isn't for me, I need to switch careers. But it really just emphasized the importance of, you know, people's well-being and, you know, managing their lives and the medical conditions that sometimes affect them.
Ivy, thanks for sharing. I think most healthcare workers are not ready to talk about the last 2 years of our lives. And like, I'm getting emotional just like hearing what Ivy said, because especially in the hospital, like it was hard because I think a lot of my friends and family were like, oh, well, you're on labor and delivery, babies are born, it's so happy. And I'm just like, can't say the things on a part like screen right now that I want to say in response. But it just, because I had a lot of sick patients, and I had patients who lost a lot of family members, a lot of widows whose partners died during the pandemic, a lot of stillbirth, a lot of real loss, a lot of ICU bedside C-sections at 31 weeks for patients who were intubated. Like, we all saw some really scary, hard things. And I think that has changed all of us. I feel like the emergency room, ICU, and labor and delivery were the only units who were like, kind of like, we can't close and people with COVID are coming in. I will say one thing that, like, to try to make this like less of a like PTC support group right now, but one thing that I think is kind of good that came out of, I don't know if I can even say that, but is telemedicine. I think telemedicine, like the fact that we didn't have access to telemedicine the way we have now was shameful. And I think it's really been great. And I think the pandemic has really forced us to sort of like pull the veil from our eyes in a lot of disparities in healthcare that were, you know, like just brought, like there's no way to not look at it right now. Like, it brought a lot into the forefront, which I think is really important, and a lot of really important conversations are being had and changes are being made. But even telemedicine, I think, increases access to care. And for a lot of my patients who, you know, would have to take the bus for an hour or two to their appointments, to be able to have a phone call or a video call on a smartphone was really great. We do more postpartum visits now because we do a telemedicine visit. So it doesn't impact the clinic. It's easier for patients who have a newborn baby to access care. And I think that's really great. And it also kind of just forced us to realize like how much of what we're doing is essential and prioritize that. And it also forced us to look at how much of what we do, how much of the money that makes healthcare run is based on elective surgeries. So, because all of those were gone. and so I think a lot of people had to look at themselves and their work and their healthcare system because of it, they had to.
Yeah. I think that's a really important point, and actually something that I wanted to ask about, the, you know, sort of what we've learned from the pandemic has been really to highlight a lot of the disparities that we have in terms of folks' access to, you know, something as simple as vaccination. And, you know, I think it's certainly been a process for us as a country to start thinking about some of the real serious problems that we have in healthcare. And so I'd love to ask you all to just like reflect a little bit on, you know, have you seen over the course of your careers changes in terms of the perspectives of the institutions that you're affiliated with when it comes to supporting equitable care across different populations?
So speaking for New York Presbyterian as an organization, we definitely saw, I wouldn't say a major shift in addressing these, you know, very apparent issues that are not spoken about a lot. I always found, at least at the location I work at, because NYP has a bunch of satellite hospitals, but in Washington Heights, you can't really ignore, you know, the disparities that you see, because that is what you see every day. When I tell you that 90% of my patients are Hispanic, Dominican, you know, probably, you know, immigrants or undocumented, you know, that is a big chunk of people that are normally ignored or don't have access to care. But here they are at this incredible hospital receiving care because this hospital happens to be located in their neighborhood. So for us, it was less of a day-to-day shift. It was more about the language the hospital was finally using. And that was something we had been talking about for years and years and years, that, you know, majority of our patients speak Spanish. Why aren't there more physicians of color? Why aren't there more providers of color? Why aren't there people who are more competent in Spanish? You know, that should be a, you know, something that is looked for in terms of like talent acquisition and HR, is people who represent the people they serve. Now that's completely different. Now there's a greater initiative to, you know, kind of amplify the workforce with people who, you know, can resemble or, you know, have kind of a better idea of where the patient's coming from. So a lot of what happens too in healthcare, as I'm sure a lot of us know, is that if people are very mistrusting of healthcare, especially Black, African-American population, Hispanic population, we, you know, Black Americans were experimented on for the majority of their history in this country. And for them to go to the doctor, it's sometimes a very traumatic experience, or they have stories of, you know, their grandparents, you know, where their conditions were ignored, or their pain was ignored, or they were told that they were, you know, fat and obese and eating unhealthy, that you should eat better, but look at the food deserts that they live in, you know, all these different intersectional things that kind of go into a patient weren't being looked at, or weren't being, you know, there weren't active initiatives to kind of facilitate that process a little bit better of how can we give this person the best care. So my day-to-day doesn't look that much different. Like I'm, you know, thankfully for my department, at least for the OT department, we, I think, are a little bit more attuned to these differences. And because our whole profession is about meeting a person where they're at and knowing that you don't know everything about a person. You're not an expert in a person who has spinal cord injury, or how to treat a Hispanic woman who, you know, doesn't have her family here. We're not experts. We go into the patient clinician relationship wanting to learn and needing to learn. So for OT, I think it kind of was just almost a little bit validating, like, hello, yes, this is what life is about. We need to be able to talk to other people, understand other people. And when we don't, we take a backseat. We listen and we learn. So I think that kind of was more so what I noticed. It's just the language finally kind of caught up to the actions that, you know, for my department, thankfully were happening, and we're getting better at doing things that we weren't so good at. Other areas of the hospital, other departments, I think kind of had this like aha moment, like, you know, oh man, we haven't been, you know, doing right by our patients.
I'll talk about it from like working within the school sector right away when the pandemic hit. We right away switched to go on remote, and it was all dependent on who has access to technology and who also has access to parental support, parents that understand the language that is being spoken, parents that can read, parents that have time to sit down and engage. And that was very much felt throughout the city. 2 days a week, I'm working in the Flushing area, but 3 days a week, I do evaluations for DOE throughout the city. And you could, even the students we were able to connect to do the evaluations, you needed to have access to two devices. So we felt it, and there was a major shift this year, the start of the year. Every student within our schools are receiving devices that are enabled with Wi-Fi. So there definitely is a shift to, you know, from before we're like, stay away from all this stuff. And it doesn't matter if some has, some doesn't have, so that everybody, we all need it. That's definitely a shift in.
Well, as we are getting close to the end of our time, I want to open it up for our attendees here. If there are folks who have questions, you can feel free to chat directly to me. You can use your microphone and or camera, but we'll open it up. We should have time for a question or two. Warda.
Okay, hi. So I had two questions. And then the first one was, what did your guys' educational journeys look like? Like what graduate school did you go to? Not like what, like the institution, but like, you know, when you graduate and then you go to school for to specialize in something like that. Like that's what I mean by what schools did you go to? And then the second question is, there was a mention of getting reimbursement for tuition. So if you could go into that, that would be helpful. Thank you.
So for our occupational therapist, can you talk a little bit about OT education?
So OT is a master's degree. And I believe now when I was graduating OT school, I'm a little bit older than Ivy, there was the introduction of getting an OTD, a doctorate. So OT at the time when I was in graduate school was 2 years of coursework and then about 6 months of field work. The way the field work was, it was divided over 2-3 month periods. I was at Tufts University, but every university does it differently. I know at Columbia, it's done differently, and you do different, it's both hands-on. So there's two level two field works, and then there's also level one field works where you're exposed, you know, and then you have coursework. But I believe now that a lot of people entering into the field are doing a 3-year degree program on the doctorate level, but I think you could jump in on that.
Yeah, so when I graduated from OT school in 2017-2018, the doctorate degree was just starting to kind of come into play at Columbia. But majority of, I think, people in the OT field right now have at least a master's degree. It used to be at a bachelor level several years back, but now I think at a minimum you have to have a master's degree. So it typically is a 2-2.5 year program. For me, ended up being a 3-year program because I did a specialty in pediatrics. I thought I was going to do pediatrics and look where I ended up. but I think similar to a lot of healthcare professions, you do the foundational coursework. That's a big chunk of your education. And then another big chunk of your education is the hands-on clinical experience, the field work. So at Columbia, for example, you do a level one field work in mental health and physical disabilities and pediatrics and geriatrics. And then your level two is the hands-on portion where by the end of your level two field work, you should be functioning as like an entry-level clinician. So I think majority, I'm sure, you know, everyone else on this panel, they can kind of attest to a similar kind of course structure. But yeah, like I said, it's very different than Barnard, where, you know, you're sitting in the classroom, you have someone lecturing to you. In graduate school, at least in the healthcare professions, it's, you know, I think more of you're now talking amongst colleagues, a professor who's teaching you, someone who's actually in the field or related to the field in some way, would, you know, in the future will be your colleague and students around you or people you're going to eventually work with. And, you know, the clinical advisors you have on field work or people that you want to make connections with for networking, for future job opportunities. I was very lucky that I did my field work at NYP Columbia, and I was ultimately hired there because of my relationship with my clinical instructor and, you know, having that that networking that I had. So, you know, school, at least OT school, is very much a professional playground, I like to say.
Liz, can you tell us about the structure of your education in PA school?
Sure. So first of all, actually, when I worked in research in Mount Sinai, I also had tuition reimbursement because I had to go back, take my classes. It's fairly simple. It's good to work at academic places like Mount Sinai, you know, places that have that offer that, but it's great. Tuition reimbursement is how I like afforded to be in the position I am. Barnard was expensive. And then for PA school, you take the requirements, which are pretty much the same across the board for PA schools nationally. It's a master's degree. The program you take, so when I applied, it was the GRE, MCAT, and now I believe they developed something called a PCAT,
PACAT.
I believe.
Yeah,
PACAT. So they are doing that.
Okay. Yeah, not new. It hasn't been adopted widely, but it is.
Yeah, I didn't know. That's after my time, so I'm not sure about that, but yeah. So you take these entrance exams, complete your coursework, and then you also have to have a minimum number of patient, like direct patient care hours, which is a little bit different from other fields. So you have to have, there's a way to do it, of quite a few ways. I was an EMT and a scribe, which some schools do not accept as direct patient care because all you do is talk to people. It's not necessarily, so CNA, medical assistant, there are a lot of other ways to do it. And then you go to PA school, which is anywhere from, I think the shortest programs are 24 months, 2 years, straight through. And if you you go to a program that gives you maybe a summer break or something, because PA school is just straight through, you don't really get breaks. You could do a 3-year program if you took a break. And then you graduate and you go right into, you take your boards and you go and work, and that's that. Oh, there are fellowships and residencies for PAs as well, which I actually have a lot of friends. That's sort of post-grad stuff that I have a lot of friends who do that, but that would be more future stuff.
Thank you. Sorry, there's all of a sudden construction going on directly outside my window. Martina, did you do an initial nursing degree and then the nurse midwifery degree?
So I had to get my license. So to be a certified nurse midwife in the US, you have to get your RN first. I was not really interested in working as an RN, which now I'm like, why not? You get paid better and you have a better schedule. But I knew the kind of care I wanted to give was specifically within the scope of midwifery. So I looked at nurse midwifery programs that had a second degree option. And so UCSF, Yale, Penn, Vanderbilt, OHSU, I'm trying to think where else I applied, all of them had a program where if you take your prereqs, you go in the first 12 months, you just get your RN, which is general. You know, you have your rotations in the whole body and all the patients. And so things that I never will probably ever do again. And then you take your nursing licensure and then you immediately go into the master's. And so based on the university, you need to know what specialty you want to go into. Nurse midwifery is a master's level degree. And so at UCSF, you had to apply specifically. I think all the ones I applied to, I had to know I wanted to be a nurse midwife rather than just a nurse practitioner. Columbia School of Nursing does have a nurse practitioner program where you just apply. And then at the end of the first year, you then can specialize. So you can say, I want to be a midwife. I want to be an adult geriatric nurse practitioner. I want to be a pediatric nurse practitioner. I want to do family nurse practitioner along the whole lifespan. So if you don't know exactly how you want to specialize, those programs exist. I'm really happy that I chose one where I knew specialty was, because everyone in my program really knew what they wanted to do and had a lot of experience leading up to that. But the general education of 12 months, I was taking those courses with people who had passions in other areas, and that was great too. And so then the nurse midwifery part of it was 24 months straight through. And then from there, you can begin practicing independently in all but 3 states in the US. You don't need physician supervision or written practice agreement, but you have a very specific scope you can work in. And so you graduate really only knowing bit, kind of like with what I think it was Liz said, like you graduate being like, I don't feel like I know anything. And so most folks, that's something to consider when you graduate is working in an environment where you can be supported. And because you really are learning more on the job, because your specialty is normalcy and wellness. So it's not like surgery where you need a residency where you actually know exactly what you're doing by the time you are on your own. It's more like you have to understand what well is, and then you have to know what unwell is. And so then you can know when to refer out.
Awesome.
So in short, 3 years total.
Was the first degree a second bachelor's or was it an initial?
It was master's? A second bachelor's. And so some of them, it depends. Some of them, it's like a BS. Some of them, yeah. It's a diploma program. And then some places you have to, but because I already had a bachelor's of arts from Barnard, yeah. It was just a diploma RN.
Yeah. Cool. Awesome. Well, we're wrapping up. Since we're almost at time, I just want to say thanks again to our panelists for spending part of your afternoons with us. We're lucky to have so many folks doing really, really interesting jobs in healthcare among our alumni community. And we thank you for being with us today. Thanks so much to those who were attending and able to listen to this, this great conversation. And we're very, very excited to continue working with you all at Students as you think about your next professional paths. All right.
Thank you all so much for joining. We'll talk soon. Thank you again to our panelists. I'll be in touch with you all. Have a great rest of your day.
Absolutely. Bye.
Bye.